The title is Curlews on the Coast. The format is, as usual, we have three panelist speakers, each one going to make a short 10-15 minute presentation, after which we will open it up to questions. If you have any questions, please put them on the chat, and then we will summarize the pick up the most relevant ones and have a discussion among the panelists. It's only the panelists who will be speaking on this. You can make comments by the chat all the way through. So without more ado, let's go ahead. Our three speakers are Katharine Bowgen, who works on curlews in North Wales with the BTO office in North Wales. That's British Trust for Ornithology, of course. She's talking about curlews round the Irish Sea. We're then going to broaden things to a wider European perspective, which is presented by Marie Donnez, who's working at the University of La Rochelle in France. She has a text with multiple participants who bring a lot of information from all over Western Europe. And then we're going on to a world scale where Nicola Crockford of RSPB International Department is going to talk about international efforts, mainly through conventions, to conserve major curlew coastal sites. So all our talks are about curlews on the coast. Please have your thoughts ready for any discussion points you'd like to raise afterwards. And as I say, put them on the chat. I'm going to mute myself now. I'm afraid there may be some sort of echo on my computer. Sorry about that. So handing over to Katharine to make her presentation. Katharine, over to you.
Thank you very much, Mike. I'll just start sharing my screen. I'll be 1 second. Okay. Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you, Mike, for the nice introduction, and to Megan as well. I'm Katharine Bowgen. I'm a research ecologist with BTO Cymru, as Mike mentioned, and I'm going to be talking to you today about curlew and their relationship to tide and lake cycles, which affect and influence their overwintering habitat selection. I'm part of BTO Cymru and the Wetland and Marine team at the British Trust for Ornithology. And this project was actually part of a much larger project across the Irish Sea with participants from both Wales and from Ireland. I say, what are we looking at this time, in the fact that I have presented many a time on different curlew projects that are coming out of the Welsh curlew and also some of the English projects as well. And in particular, we were interested in curlew habitat preferences around the Irish Sea. And what we've done is we are adding in information for the non-breeding season to fully understand the entire annual life cycle of the species in this area. A lot of work is done on the breeding side of things, and we want to make sure that we can fully understand the preferences of these birds to help influence conservation, but also understanding of why they might be selecting certain areas at different times. The BTO Cymru, we joined a consortium of organisations which were interested in investigating bird habitats in winter, and this was called the ECHOES project. It's a project looking at the effects of climate change on bird habitats around the Irish Sea, and it actually lasted for about 3 years before it ended this year with a fantastic conference that I know a few people attended here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to present some of the work the BTO were involved in, that we are taking on to hopefully put together into a scientific paper, which will go on to help influence other people's decisions. So hopefully it will let me change. Yes, so I couldn't have done this without the funding from the EU Ireland Wales programme. It was a fantastic interreg programme that allowed us to all join together across countries. So you can see this little map in the top right. We have the yellow area, which is where we were all linked up. So we had us in North Wales, we had Aberystwyth University, we had Cork University, and we had several other organisations who were more specific on some of the IT or the geophysical side of things, based in Aberystwyth in Dublin. It says effect of climate change on bird habits out around the Irish Sea, and we're only doing a small part of the project. There was a whole load of process. They were looking at both curlew and Greenland white-fronted geese in winter to try and cover sort of two large important species, and I say large in terms of their importance to the conservation world, looking at creating new habitat and land cover maps. And then our work was taking the GPS tag data from curlew and looking at making something called a resource selection function. I'll explain what this is. I won't make it too technical, I promise. Using the GPS satellite tracks to understand the habitat use of the model. And then the data from our project and the models that we created out of these to understand why birds were choosing particular habitats and what habitats they were using were going to be put into bigger species distribution models and climate change models to develop an online platform to assist stakeholders and managers' decisions. We worked in Wales and in Ireland at three different locations. We had the Cefni Valley in Anglesey, which I've kind of highlighted, the Dovey Estuary, which many of you will know is sort of widely renowned for its bird populations, and also Ballyteague down in Wexford. I'm not sure how many people know this area, but absolutely beautiful, great area, lots of bird life, and amusingly, quite a lot of our birds from some of our English curlew projects have ended up wintering out that way as well. So we're learning more about how important this area is. We did GPS tracking. We used small tags from PathTrack that you can see an example of in the top right. These were attached to curlew for a temporary basis. They lasted until they molted, and they gave us fantastic amount of fixes across the wintering period to understand where birds were using, right down to a 15-minute timescale. We had 36 curlew that we managed to catch in our project, and we had them spread across three different sites. Unfortunately, COVID got in the way, and also so did avian influenza. So we did get a bit restricted on how many tags we got out. But these 36 tags provided us with over 221,000 locations across the winter. Absolutely excellent data. And with it being at a 15-minute timescale with no loss of battery life, we were able to fully appreciate quite how the birds were using these habitats on a fine scale. This is just an example of some birds down in Ballyteague. The colours just are indicating different birds and showing clusters of points where they were really fascinated in areas going backwards and forwards. And there's, you can see on the coastline, I'm not sure if you can see my mouse, hopefully you can. There was this lovely area inland which had a spit hiding in between it, which led up to a dam, and lots of birds were using them. But you can see quite how far inland some of these were travelling in this wonderful mosaic habitat. And we wanted to know a bit more why. I'm now going to go on to a little bit of the technical side of things, but hopefully I've made it understandable without being over the top. So something called a resource selection function. This is a type of statistical model to understand why birds are using certain resources. You can use it for other species as well. And we have from our data a GPS point, and we'll know the date, the time. We'll know whether it was day or night, we'll know whether it's high tide, low tide, what the moon state was, and we'll also know what type of habitat that was. So here's an example of an intertidal mud flat piece. Why did they choose that when there's so many other habitats around? So what we did was we put up these so-called fake pseudo points around to say, why did it choose these when within the same sort of distance that it travelled, it could have picked any of these different habitats? And then we throw it all into a computer model. And this works out the probability of a bird selecting that particular habitat in relation to the availability of all other habitats. Why did it choose that one? We then add in some extra information to our models to try and gauge the fact that it might not just have been a choice for that habitat with the resources on it, but it might have been related to whether it was day or night, the tidal state, lunar illumination as well. We know the birds feed at night. We've seen them from our GPS tags and also watched them with thermal cameras out on mudflats. But also how far away from the coast were they and how high above sea level? We threw all of these into a model to understand quite what might be going on with the birds. And I should say we did validate everything against another tracking data set, just to be sure. with all these different functions, we could create a whole load of scenarios, 30 odd scenarios. You don't need to understand this. It's just to show you we've tried loads of different tidal states, where how many hours beyond and high, close to high tide it was, different moons and whether it was day or night. And this is what we come out with. We found out that birds, as you might expect, over-selected for, so this is given all chance for all the habitats around, they over-selected for estuary, intertidal mudflats and salt marsh over and above everything, day or night, which makes sense. We know that's where we see the birds. More interestingly, particularly in Ireland, we saw that these complex cultivation patterns, which I should say is a technical EU term for a particular type of agriculture, was being over-selected for as well. We weren't quite expecting it to be as specific to that. We were thinking it'd be slightly more related to day or night. So it was interesting to know these were also very interested, though they were slightly more biased towards the Irish side of things. We then looked and saw that non-irrigated arable land was being used, slightly more at high tides, but natural grassland was being completely avoided at night, and it was being negatively underselected for during the daytime. A couple of extra habitats that we saw that were interesting as well was the inland marshes were being overselected for during the day, but they were being underselected for at night. So these were only interesting at daytime, and pastures were uniformly slightly underselected for all states. Looking in at high and low tide specifically, you might have imagined beach dunes and sands being used, but mainly at high tide, but not at low tide. And pastures again were being underselected for. So we can put all of these together into maps. It's like I've shown you all these tables and I've removed any of the statistical numbers, but we can put them around the entire coastline. And if I flick between neap high tide in day and night, you can see a change in the colour going backwards and forwards, showing that different habitats have got a preference within a 10 kilometre buffer around the coastline. And if we look at spring high tide as well, we can see that day and night again play a different role, and we have slight differences between each of the areas. So we know that tidal cycles are influential, and I forgot to say for the previous one how influential the grasslands are. You might look at this and go, oh, that's all fair and well, but we can get this right down to tiny detail. This is the Kevney Valley, so just a brief reminder of where it is in the bottom right, and we can see that it's over selecting for where it's yellow and under selecting for where it's darker purple. And we can go back and forth between high tide and low tide. And you might be interested that some of that underselection in the bottom right is a forestry area, which makes sense, just to give you a scale of the coastline. And we can take this through for all of our sites. So this is Ballyteague. We can see back and forth is a little bit more subtle in its preferences. So different habitats leaning into different preferences for birds in different areas, just to give you an idea of where the coastline is. And finally, most interestingly, this is the Dovey Estuary, which behaves slightly, the birds behave differently to the other two sites. We think this might have been to do with the higher elevation levels, which are cut off in white. And from high tide to low tide, we could see how important the tidal estuary was. It's very little in its change of preference, really was the focus of the birds. And we saw that we're trying to collect the data. We really struggled to actually get good places for our base stations to download the data. And there's an example of where it is in real life, not just on our map. Other interesting points that we discovered is that birds continue to travel long distances inland. And this in Ireland, they went out to a set of islands as well. No one, not even NPWS, knew they were using these. And so they're now going to go out and investigate this island to find out exactly why it's interesting for curlews during the winter. And as I mentioned, in Mid Wales, we noticed a real avoidance of high elevation. You can see all of these birds in multicolours picking up around this area. So I kind of rushed through it, but I wanted to say that tide and light cycles strongly influence habitat selection. And although coastal areas are preferred, the track birds travelled quite a long way inland, really, to choose suitable habitat. They know where they're going and what they want. Our results are already informing habitat management decisions in certain locations, who partners who are part of the project, and how they can benefit overwintering curlew, particularly thinking about day and nighttime preferences. We don't see curlew much at night unless you've got a thermal scope, and this allows us to understand these additional areas that are important to conserve, not just what we see in the day. And we're going to be applying this further into the breeding season. As always, I always ask people to keep an eye out for our curlew. We use multiple schemes. Tony Cross's scheme in Mid Wales was also used, as well as the scheme down in Ireland. If you see them, please do report them in to us. And there are many people to thank, but I realise that I'm reaching just the end of my time. And hopefully that's all been OK, Mike. Thank you to all who were involved in this project.
Thanks very much, Katharine, and for keeping to time as well. Perhaps when we come to discussion, there'll be time for you to say a little bit more about exactly how you use this thing for these data for management results. I think that would be quite interesting. And can I remind any participants that if they've got any questions for Katharine, please put a question in on the chat and we'll try and get to them when the time comes. So without more ado, let's go to Atlantic France and to La Rochelle, its famous rugby team, as well as its famous university. And let's invite Marie to talk to us about her project. Marie, over to you. If you have any English problems, just ask and we'll help to translate. Maggie, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Thanks, Queen. So, hi, everybody. I'm very happy to be here today to present you our research on the spatiotemporal use of winter insights by Eurasian curlews in Europe. So this study is the first of my PhD thesis conducted at La Rochelle University under the supervision of Pierrick Boucher and in close collaboration with Philippe Schwemmer from the University of Kiel in Germany. So just a little bit of context. For this study, we focused on the subspecies Numenius aquata that can be found throughout Europe, as well as in Western North Africa. And as you know, this species is a migratory species, which use weather, agricultural habitats during the breeding period and coastal habitats during the wintering period. At the European scale, the species has shown a sharp decline since the 1980s, with an estimated number of breeding pairs between 212,000 and 292,000 pairs in 2015. So the species is then classified as near threatened on the European Red List. So during winter, birds face several threats that can accentuate their decline, including hunting activities, especially in France, but also the loss of the habitats, the disturbance, and the decrease of the food resources, for example. So the objective of this study was to provide for the first time data on the spatiotemporal use of wintering sites by Eurasian curlew across almost their entire wintering range. We would like to focus on geographic distribution of curlews in Europe, on their local space use through homage analysis, on their habitat use, and also on their wintering phenology. So an European collaboration between eight research and conservation programs from seven countries in Europe was set up for the study. Nearly 300 curlews were tagged with GPS devices between 2014 and 2021. Ever at their breeding site in red on the map, or directly at their wintering site in blue on the map, that is ever in the Pertuis-Charente in France and in the German Warden Sea. And a total of 204 adults were kept for the study, and for these birds, only the longest wintering period were retained if multiple recorded periods were done. Homages of curlews on their wintering sites were carried out for birds with at least 90 days and 2,000 GPS fixes recorded. And homages were calculated using the canon density estimation method, as we can see on this figure. So now, if we look at the spatial use of curlews during the winter, track curlews wintered at 66 sites spread over a large geographical area from Morocco to Scotland. The number of individual pair sites is represented by more or less large diagram on the map, and the coastal or inland position of the individuals is defined by different colors. So we have seen that birds were very faithful to their wintering site throughout the wintering period, with only 13 individuals having changed site during winter. And we have also seen that most of the birds used exclusively coastal habitats, but it's habitats located less than 2 kilometers from the coast, even if few birds use also inland habitats. And this remained true even if the individuals directly caught at the 2 coastal wintering sites were removed from the analysis. Forage sizes were highly variable between individuals, with a minimum size of 46 hectares and a maximum size of about 2,400 hectares. This homing size was comparable to other short species, such as the American ostercatchers and the barred goldwit, but it was much smaller than birds known to be very gregarious, such as Donnez and Wednuts, for example. So it could indicate that curlews are only slightly gregarious on a small scale during the winter. And by comparing the homing size of individuals wintering in the Perche-Charente, in the Warden Sea, and in oversights, we determined that birds wintering in the Warden Seas had significantly larger homages than all the others. So another study will be done to understand this difference by testing some factors known to affect the size of individuals' homages. For example, we can test the food availability for birds, the location of their roosts, the number of individual pair size, and many other factors. The presence or absence of different habitat types within the homages has also been done. 8 habitats were almost exclusively used by individuals, which were the mudflats, the sandflats, the salt marshes, the rocky shores, the marshes, the saltworks, the meadows, and the crops. And we have seen that curlews used between 1 and 6 different habitats during the winter. And on these different habitats, more than half of the individuals used exclusively the mudflats, which is already well documented, but also the salt marshes, which sometimes represented the only habitat used by the individuals, and which was therefore sufficient for them to carry out all their wintering activities, that is to feed and to rest. So now concerning the temporary use of birds, this figure shows the wintering phenology of curlews in Julian Day according to the latitude of their wintering site in A and the latitude of their breeding site in B. So we can see that curlews tagged directly on their wintering site in the Perche-Charente and in the Warden Sea will breed at high latitudes, namely in Russia and in Finland. And these birds will have a longer wintering period due to a later pre-breeding migration departure. So this study confirmed previous results, according to which the latitude of a breeding site seems to condition the departure for migration of individuals. So to conclude, this study shows that curlews are very faithful to their wintering site who had their wintering period, but they have relatively small and variable home ranges compared to gregarious shoreline species. But it also shows that curlews are able to use a high diversity of coastal and inland habitats, but that most of the birds were exclusively coastal and used mudflats, but also salt marshes. And this study raises concerns about the capacity of these near-threatened species to respond to environmental modification in coastal regions, because the high inter-individual variability in the use of space could help the species to respond to global climate change. However, the high site fidelity during winter suggests that many individuals might be unable to adapt their habitat use or change their sites if necessary. So thank you for listening. Just to let you know that this study is available in the Wetland Journal, and feel free to contact me for more information. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marie, and congratulations on getting through a presentation in a foreign language. I know how difficult it is. Well done. I'm sure we will have a lot of questions to come up later. I can certainly think of some, but for the moment, let's carry on and invite Nicola to talk on a worldwide scale after Marie has already introduced the coastal scale. Can I remind you that Curlew Action, although it does a lot of work in the British Isles, is trying very much to extend its scope to international operations, simply because our Eurasian Curlew and all the other Curlews are migrants right across the world. So we're not interested only just in Curlew in the British Isles in Curlew Action. Nicola, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mike. It's a really great pleasure to contribute to this webinar of the wonderful Curlew Action, and I much enjoyed the two preceding talks. Absolutely fascinating. Curlews are birds very close to my heart, ever since as a child in Northumberland. A soundtrack of spring was that skirling call of the pairs that nested in the fields behind our house. Then about 15 years ago, when appointed chair of the Slenderbill Curlew Working Group, I led a search across more than 30 countries of the non-breeding range, which Mike was involved in, to prove that the species still exists. Despite the enormous efforts by hundreds of highly skilled volunteers, we failed to provide this proof, though we did find much else. Next slide, please. At the same time as we did that search, 2008, the Eurasian Curlew was ranked globally near threatened on the IUCN Red List, in large part due to low breeding productivity in the British Isles. So it became my mission to ensure the bird was given top UK conservation priority, duly achieved, I think, and in no small part due to Mary, Mike and all of you at Curlew Action, duly acted upon. This picture by Kim Atkinson, which you can also see behind me, reminds me what it's all about. And while we rightly invest so much effort in improving breeding conditions, it is easy to forget that for most of the year, the curlew is a coastal water bird, as so ably illustrated just now by the two preceding talks. Next slide, please. As is or was the Slenderbill curlew, for which the loss of coastal wetlands is considered to be a factor in its decline, and as is the spoonbill sandpiper of the East Asian Australasian flyway, to which I've now devoted myself to help prevent them following the Slenderbill curlew down the plug hole, focusing on trying to save the Yellow Sea staging areas. Next slide, please. It's partly because of the catastrophic declines of the Yellow Sea waterbirds that coastal waterbirds are considered to be among the planet's most threatened migratory birds, with about a quarter, together with ski birds, in danger of extinction. This analysis is actually from 2018, but BirdLife is aiming to review the red list status of all the world's waders by next year, and the signs are that this will paint an even bleaker picture. Hence, coastal wetland conservation is among the four priorities of BirdLife International's Global Flyways Programme, for which I'm the policy lead. So over the past decade or so, I focused on finding ways to scale up coastal wetland conservation using intergovernmental policy processes to help deliver on-the-ground action, with the status of migratory waterbirds as an indicator of progress. So in this talk, I want to update you on three main approaches I've taken for this. Next slide, please. So the first of these is to use the World Heritage Convention of UNESCO to protect top coastal wetlands for migratory waterbirds. And it was the spoonbill sandpiper that taught me its power. This bird, like millions of other waterbirds of the East Asian Australasian flyway, shown on the left-hand map, depends on the vast tidal flats of the Yellow Sea, see the right-hand map, for spring and autumn staging. Back in 2006, South Korea destroyed the Spoonie's most important staging site, building a 32-kilometre dam across the Semangam estuary, shown by the star. You may recall the scandal of the World Scout Jamboree held there this summer, a symbol of the ghastly pointlessness of the whole exercise. A decade later, it was discovered that the most important staging site for spoonies was now Chaozini, the lower blue spot on the map across the Yellow Sea in China's Jiangsu province. Half the world's 700 remaining spoonbill sandpipers staged there every autumn. But by the time we discovered it, permission had already been given to destroy it through an even bigger reclamation project than Simangum. How on earth to stop such a disaster? Surely the death knell for the spoonbill sandpiper in a country that does not respond well to international criticism. To cut a long story short, since we were never going to stop it on legal or economic grounds, we appealed to China's national pride, pointing out that it was about the most important coastal wetland in the world and they should consider getting it listed as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And they bought it, to everyone's amazement, not least mine, having first proposed the idea to them in August 2016 in Beijing at an IUCN-convened bilateral meeting on conservation of the Yellow Sea that I facilitated between China and South Korea. In January 2017, China officially began the nomination process and Chaozini was inscribed by the World Heritage Committee at their meeting in Baku, Azerbaijan in 2019. The picture top right shows that historic moment. In fact, out of the ashes of Simangum, South Korea had already been working since 2012 on a World Heritage nomination for their remaining tidal flats. This might have helped convince China to pursue the World Heritage route. A little bit of intergovernmental competition can be quite helpful, as can support from governments who've already demonstrated the success of an approach. In this case, the Wadden Sea World Heritage Site shared by Germany, Denmark and the Netherlands. It was interesting, however, that on the advice of UNESCO and their technical advisor IUCN, the Yellow Sea World Heritage inscriptions of both China and the following year, Korea, the photo on the left shows the Korean celebration under pandemic conditions. Those inscriptions were purely on the basis of migratory birds rather than also other broader criteria underpinning the Wadden Sea inscription. Now at Chaozini, the big hoardings of 2016 promoting the development have been replaced by information panels celebrating the World Heritage Site, and the diggers busily reclaiming tidal flats are replaced by peacefully feeding spoonbill sandpipers. Next slide, please. I went back to Chaozini last month for the first time since the pandemic, including to visit the team of researchers working to understand the feeding ecology of the spoonbill sandpipers, see top right. The amount of spoonbill sandpiper imagery was quite overwhelmingly. Basically, outside the EU, World Heritage is by far the most powerful and politically high profile international site designation. Countries have to take huge steps towards conservation of the site, even just in the process of nomination. Next slide, please. You can see why this experience in the Yellow Sea and that of the Wadden Sea across the North Sea from us made me think, why can't we have a coastal wetland World Heritage Site for migratory waterbirds here in the UK? The North Sea plays a similar role to the Yellow Sea as a vital rung in the migratory ladder. And when you think about it in global terms, the UK's most important biodiversity asset is our migratory waterbirds, not least curlew and seabirds. Next slide, please. Last year, the RSPB's wonderful Jeff Q picked up this challenge. Together with WWT and the National Trust, we submitted a proposal to the UK government that they should add all the coastal wetland protected areas from the Humber to the Thames in a site we termed the East Coast Flyway to their World Heritage tentative list. And on Easter Monday this year, they did. The area we are nominating covers at least 170,000 hectares, which is a similar size to the Wadden Sea and Yellow Sea sites, mostly comprising 21 already protected areas split between six different local governments. Luckily, they are all on board with this nomination, as is the Crown Estate, which owns much of the intertidal land. The nomination process will take years, 2028 being the very earliest we could hope for inscription. And bear in mind that the Wadden Sea took more like 30 years. But just think of the opportunities for curlew merchandising. Though, why go to all this trouble if the site's already protected? Well, the World Heritage process is really the only mechanism one can think of that can hope to get all those local governments, national agencies like Natural England, the Environment Agency and the Crown Estate, and other stakeholders to manage that length of coast with a shared vision as a single ecological and geomorphological unit, the way our curlews and other migratory water birds use it. And it's especially urgent in the face of sea level rise and so on. Likewise, I reckon it's our best hope of raising national pride and awareness of the UK's global importance for migratory water birds. World Heritage listing of the East Coast Flyway puts it on a par with the Great Barrier Reef and the Galapagos. Furthermore, it will hopefully put the final nail in the coffin of the crazy proposal to build a wash barrage. No Samangam here, thank you very much. Next slide, please. Now, the Wadden Sea and the Yellow Sea World Heritage Sites were granted on the understanding that those countries would support conservation of their migratory birds also along the flyway. And the same is likely to be true of the East Coast Flyway. Furthermore, World Heritage is the only international protection designation that can be applied to chains or networks of physically disconnected but thematically connected sites. These can be inscribed as what are called serial transnational sites. The world already agreed last year in the Global Biodiversity Framework to conserve by 2030 at least 30% of coastal areas through well-connected systems of protected areas and other effective area-based conservation measures, which are known as OECMs. So the second area of work that I wanted to flag that we're embarking on is piloting ways of delivering that well-connected element. So currently, important sites for migratory birds are, of course, identified on the basis of count data, often supplied thanks to citizen scientists, which doubtfully includes many of you. While this is the best measure we have, it has its limitations. For example, sites that are difficult for water birds to reach may be underrepresented, as may staging areas where there is high turnover of birds that is not picked up by peak counts, even if counts are made during the passage period rather than just midwinter. But data now available on ecological connectivity from bird tracking, like we've just been hearing about, as well as analysis of ringing recoveries and sightings, we can add a new layer to our understanding of which sites are of critical importance for migratory birds and how they're connected. So firstly, in tackling this challenge, to defend the Tagus estuary, Portugal's most important coastal wetland, from a planned airport, the RSPB analysed all of that connectivity data for the Tagus. We showed that the airport would not only detrimentally affect the Tagus waterbird populations, but also undermine conservation efforts in about 300 protected areas across 30 countries. Apparently, this evidence is being influential in the national court case to stop the airport, as well as with the European Commission. Next slide, please. RSPB and BirdLife are now funding, building on that work, a two-year pilot project using network analysis of connectivity data to identify the critical nodes in the East Atlantic flyway of several coastal water birds. The work is being done by Martin Beale, led by Jose Alves and Maria Dias from a couple of Portuguese universities. These rungs of the ladder will include sites we need to protect where the birds are highly concentrated, such as coastal wetlands in the non-breeding season, as well as areas where the birds are more dispersed, such as farmland during the nesting season, which would be more suited to these OECMs. Remove any one of the critical rungs of such migratory ladders and the population is put at risk. The idea is to map a common agenda of priority areas for governments and other stakeholders to help us plan better to enable the network to be managed and restored to sustain these populations in the face of sea level rise, climate change and other threats. Understanding these avian connections between sites can also strengthen the human connections, for example, twinnings between sites that share the same birds, capacity building, north-south investment. Next slide, please. Here's initial outputs from that project for black-tailed godwit. The lines on the left link the locations where birds were ringed with those where the rings were recovered. And on the right, they show the tracks of the tagged birds. And they highlight certain key migratory hubs for these birds that breed mainly in Iceland and in the Netherlands. The Iberian wetlands of Doñana and Tagus are clearly highly connected, as are the West African wetlands of the Senegal River and in the Niger Delta. And some of those key West African sites pinpointed are not even listed as important bird areas. Next slide, please. Martin is now working on analysis of the data he's collected, probably with your help, for Curlews, with tracks of 300 birds so far assembled. Next slide, please. In parallel to these analyses, we are working with the treaties on a project to help deliver that well-connected piece of the global biodiversity framework. While the Convention on Migratory Species requires parties to deliver conservation of ecological networks, it lacks its own mechanism for designating key areas, but uniquely World Heritage can provide it. Like I said, it can inscribe serial transnational sites where each component may not individually have the outstanding universal value necessary for World Heritage listing, but collectively the string of pearls needed to sustain key migratory bird populations could achieve that. So we're putting together a proposal with UNESCO and IUCN World Heritage, the CMS family, Ramsar, Wetlands International, WCMC, about doing a global review of such potential flyway ecological networks, which could be World Heritage sites, in conjunction with Ramsar sites and other designations and at these OECMs. We'll probably start with a pilot here in the African Eurasian Flyway for water birds, maybe even just coastal water birds to start with, and then it could be scaled up to other flyways and other taxa. The outputs will be published in the IUCN World Heritage Programme report series on potential World Heritage sites and as a module of the CMS Atlas on animal migration. Next slide, please. So the third thing I want to talk about is that basically, you know, so far I've talked about identification and protection of coastal wetland sites, which is all very well, but what about ensuring the habitat is effectively managed and restored? This slide shows the website of the new World Coastal Forum, which was launched last month in China to help all stakeholders achieve just that. So this is the third thing I want to tell you about. The World Coastal Forum is apparently the first, next slide please, initiative focused on supporting implementation of specific biodiversity commitments that's been called for by all three relevant global treaties and IUCN. This is in recognition that efforts to conserve coastal ecosystems are exceptionally fragmented, not helped by the fact that, for example, even at national government level, usually terrestrial and marine issues are dealt with by different ministries, with the coast falling in the gaps between. The declines of migratory water birds are a symptom of this. Coastal nations urgently need to replan their coasts to adapt to rising sea levels and for disaster risk reduction in the face of climate change exacerbated extreme weather events, as well as to capitalise on the huge potential coastal ecosystems have for storing carbon and providing other ecosystem services. This presents opportunities. While there are lots of good initiatives going on around the world on coastal wetland conservation, they are currently less than the sum of their parts. The World Coastal Forum plans to change that, to help deliver coastal ecosystem conservation at the scale and rate necessary to stem the declines of the water birds and the threats to ourselves. I like to think of it as turning the multilaterally agreed words into actual birds. The World Coastal Forum process was first championed by Brazil, then Canada, then Philippines, and now China. Next slide, please. The big inaugural conference announced last November by President Xi Jinping himself and hosted by China's Ministry of National Resources was why I was in China last month. Here's the ceremony formalizing the 21 founding partners, including most of the big international organizations you'd expect to be involved. And the forum is intended to be an efficient one-stop shop for showcasing and scaling up successes in coastal conservation from local communities to global, to the world's governments, businesses and beyond, and channeling state-of-the-art evidence and decision support tools back to conservation practitioners on the ground to build capacity and effectiveness, as well as mobilizing resources. Next slide, please. At the conference, projects to develop two flagship knowledge products were launched. The first is the State of the World's Coastal Ecosystems, which will act as a baseline, the first time bringing together all of the information on the state of ecosystems and species of the coasts. That's being done by IUCN and James Cook University. And then the second is being led by University of Cambridge, and it's to develop a World Coastal Ecosystem Conservation Toolkit, which will be an open access online database for creation and dissemination of science and evidence-based guidance on everything you need to do on coastal protection, restoration and management. Next slide, please. These will underpin all our work on coasts and help identify shared priorities and the most effective ways of protecting, managing and restoring coasts. So much of the implementation work of the World Coastal Forum is led by task teams. For example, one on management may focus on getting implementation of guidance on management of working coastal wetlands like shell fisheries to mutual benefit of birds and people. The principles are the same the world over, so we should help people avoid wasting time in reinventing the wheel or wasting resources on ineffective methods. Next slide, please. The restoration task team being led by the big Rest Coast project is enormously important. It may support countries to undertake reviews of their national coast to prioritise and plan where ecosystem restoration should take place, like the RSPB has done for the UK in our Sustainable Shores project. And it will support scaling up of innovative techniques, such as the managed realignments we've pioneered here in the UK, as at Wallasey, shown here. Next slide, please. And with that, I thank you for listening and urge everyone to do what you can to save our coastal wetlands and feel free to engage in the World Coastal Forum. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Nicola. That's pretty breathtaking, all that. Even to someone like me, I've been involved in world conventions over quite a long time and indeed have taken particularly the Ramsar Convention, which was one of the earliest ones, and have been involved in listing of some major world wetlands as World Heritage Sites. Should we perhaps begin the discussion by following up that a little bit? As I say, I've worked a fair bit with international conventions, and it always seems to me that all international conventions work best when you have both an informed, an interested and active secretariat who are willing to gently persuade the governments to do things, and really good contacts with people on the ground who can feed information in to the secretariats so that they can gently press the governments to whom they are, of course, responsible. Is that your experience? Do you want to develop that a bit?
I couldn't agree more. Those are two key ingredients, together with having governments, can-do people in governments who are willing to give the political backing to it. I think that's the other ingredient. But it needs to have all of those three dimensions, the people on the ground, including through NGOs and other organisations, and committed secretariat staff, but it has to also have that backing from governments, and that often needs to have one or two governments who are prepared to really show leadership.
Katharine, I don't know, do you have any comments on that sort of broader approach that Nicola has been talking about in relation to your sites on both sides of the Irish Sea?
I highly agree with everything she's been saying. It's definitely the interconnectedness of what we're able to provide is the only way forward to be able to preserve the entirety of birds' habitats. They often say sort of birds know no borders, and that's the best way to say it, I think, in the fact that they don't know the difference. And if we don't work together to be able to conserve all of the sites that are important at the same time, we're going to find, as we've seen over in China when Qi and Simangan, where key sites are lost, that the species just get gently chipped away at until they're not able to support themselves anymore.
Nicola, you already referred to the Wadden Sea. I can remember years ago in the 1960s and 1970s when the German and Danish governments were talking of reclaiming chunks of the current Wadden Sea for agriculture, and it was only then, when people started to get together, that it had some impact. And I wonder, Marie, do you have any thoughts on this about the sort of efforts that might be carried on in Europe, or any further efforts that need to be done?
I think it's very important to compile all the data that we can have with different programs. So it's what we try to do with our study. But I don't know what I can say to what thing I can add. But yeah, for me, it's really important to compile all the data and to meet people from different countries to exchange our research and speak about that.
And you were speaking, you were talking, Marie, quite a lot about birds coming from Central and Eastern Europe, which come to winter in your area of the French Atlantic coast. And there a lot of people in France, I know, but also in lots of other countries, worry about the possibility of curlews being shot by French hunters. Can you say a bit? And the French hunters have used the argument that hunting is permissible and sustainable on the French coast because the Eastern Europe populations of curlews are not decreasing as other West birds nesting in Finland or Sweden or Germany are. I find that difficult to believe. Can you say something about breeding curlews from further east in Russia, Belarusia, Ukraine, and there?
Yes, so I don't have numbers to give, but we study the breeding period of many curlews in Russia, in Finland, and Belarusia. And we found that the breeding success was very low in these regions. As you know, there are breeding sites. But maybe they think that because many curlew used bogs and abundant farmlands during the breeding period, and these habitats are less used by humans. So maybe they say that because curlews are less impacted by human activities in these habitats. But of course, the breeding success is very low. So I don't think that curlews are less impacted in these regions than in other regions. And it's not an argument to hunt the birds in France.
This is something that's been on the mind of members of Curlew Action for quite a long time, to try and create better contacts with people working on curlews in the Central and Eastern Europe. Of course, current political conditions don't help here. But I think we ought to try and work very hard with Russian and Ukrainian and Belarusian scientists, or difficult though it may be. I'm wondering if any one of the three of you panelists have thoughts on what Curlew Action might do to promote the issues you've been talking about this evening. What do you think the things that we could usefully do as an organisation?
To what extent is your work focused on the breeding grounds, and to what extent do you already have a focus on the curlews when they're on the coasts?
I think it would be fair to say that we've probably concentrated more on the breeding grounds, because the basic problem of curlews is they just don't produce enough chicks. But one of the reasons for holding this webinar and on coastal birds is to try and direct more interest and attention to that subject.
I think it'd be wonderful if Curlew Action, you know, in the same way it's done such wonders during the breeding season, could help to raise awareness of the needs of curlews. And, you know, I think it's really important, the work of both Katharine and Marie, highlighting that the birds are just not just on the intertidal land, but often they're on some of the hinterland, which may not be protected. And it's an interesting thing in the East Asian Australasian flyway that we are finding, and I think this is broader than that flyway, that we are finding that the main constraint for migratory water birds is the roost site availability rather than the feeding grounds. And I don't know whether, you know, Mary and Katharine are finding that at all, that is a constraint, that the high tide roost sites are in short supply. But, you know, presumably sometimes when they're inland, it's when they are on the high tide roosts. And, you know, maybe we should be thinking and you know, potentially even thinking about this in relation to the East Coast flyway, of making sure that there are at least buffer zones for curlews and other birds to use during high tide.
That's a really good point, Nicola. I would agree that actually sort of making sure people are aware to actually look out for curlew further inland during winter is just as important. I was trying to think of a way that would be sensible to sort of help promote this through curlew action. And I was actually, one of the simplest things I was thinking was actually getting people aware to not just look for curlew on the mudflats, but look further inland. And you very politely and carefully explained that. We've had, with the work that we've done in Ireland in particular, we've had a field assistant who was cycling around the entirety of Wexford, finding all these sites where our GPS tags were going. He was saying, I didn't know curlew were here. And he was a Wexford boy and knew exactly. Luke, I'd like to give him a shout out. He did amazing work, knowing how far inland they were going and what fields and what was the composition of those fields. And you talk to the farmers and the farmers know, but they don't think it's of interest. It's like, well, the curlew have always been there. And it's not to say that they don't care. It's more the fact that they didn't realise that was new to a lot of people. And in terms of the young birds, you've mentioned sort of working with the breeding season a lot more. Actually knowing how well those young birds do during winter, spotting out for them. I had a lovely reciting of a young bird that had been tagged as a juvenile sent to me this week, which was fantastic to actually know that it had moved several hundred miles away to the West Country, which was really quite exciting. This was an English bird, I should say. I do work on some English ones as well as Welsh ones. So promoting the fact, yeah, going inland and reciting younger birds is just as important.
Katharine, could you say a bit more about what curlews do at night? Because you were mentioning that in your presentation. And I know in some places, curlew do seem to choose a night roost and to spend the night there, whereas in other places, they seem to feed a lot, particularly by moonlight. But that's only a very general observation from me, from looking at curlews in the field. Could you develop that a bit, please?
Yes, I'll try to do my best. So the one thing I should say is we did include moonlight in our models. The reason I haven't shown about the results as much is we actually struggled to get the proper effects out without adding cloud cover. This is one of our future additions. It's great knowing the moon is out there, but if the clouds are all over, it's not as useful. So we don't know as much about the moonlight in our models, though we'll be adding it. But definitely the birds were both feeding on the mudflats at night. We can see from the GPS tracks that they weren't just stationary in one position, they were moving round. But it really was down to individuals. We had some birds that spent all their time on the mudflats. Our first winter versus some that went inland. Our first winter, we were heavily restricted by COVID and we were only able to make a small catch. And of six birds that were caught at the same time, we had one that spent its entirety on the mudflat the whole way through the winter. Three of them that travelled over a kilometre inland to specific fields in a conservation wetland area. They were happily spending some night times there. But we had others that were sort of jumping backwards and forwards. And I think I saw a comment in the chat, someone asking me why they were avoiding grasslands at night. And our current thought is that actually it might be a higher risk for predation. If you're in the darkness in a field at night, you've got less visibility and more chance for, if you're roosting, for birds to potentially have a risk. But it wasn't certain. There definitely was a general avoidance, but we saw at nighttime that it was very individual. But both areas were important, and we're hoping to be able to tweak this out a little bit more in regards to moonlight whilst we've added in cloud cover. Was it a wet day or was it a bright, clear, moonlit sky?
So are you saying that most, in general, you don't think that curlews use night roosts? They move around according to tidal conditions and according to feeding conditions?
There were some birds that definitely had a night roost that they definitely went backwards and forwards to, that they preferred. But it wasn't necessarily, if there was a low tide period overnight, they would make use of that as well. They need enough food that they would make use of it for a more limited period during the night. So they definitely have nighttime roosts as they have daytime roosts, but they're in similar sort of locations to some of their daytime areas, but there was a little bit more of an over preference in a number of individuals.
And Marie, you were talking about the size of the home range, you called it, I think, HR, yes, of curlews. Do your studies there fit with what Katharine was just saying? Do you think that your birds, you said they have different size home ranges. Could you develop that and talk a bit about that? Why do some have bigger home ranges and others have much smaller ones? Is that because they're moving more to feed, or why?
We tested some parameters to understand this difference. So we tested the sex, body mass of birds, and the latitude. But we have found that only the latitude had an impact on the home range size of the birds. But it was due to wild and seabirds. So the idea is to search other parameters that can affect the size of the home range. But we think that home range of the wild and sea are very huge because birds need to travel a lot to be in feeding areas, and because they use also the islands around the wild and sea as roosts, so they need to fly more to be in the feeding areas. But it's maybe also due to the number of individuals in each site. So because we know that the Wadden Sea had many birds during winter and many migratory birds. So yeah, we think that it's really due to these parameters. But of course, maybe there are other parameters to test. So yeah, we will see. And for our study, we study only the habitat use of birds, but as Katharine said, it's necessary to study also the selection of habitats by birds and not only the use of habitats. So it's what we will do in the next study.
Fine, thank you. There's a question on the chat asking what proportion of pairs actually rear young successfully on an annual basis. And that's a question that's been addressed in several of these webinars. And perhaps I might quote from my own direct experience. We have a Wildfowl and Wetlands Trust project on breeding curlews in the Severn Vale. This summer, there were 34 territorial pairs actually holding territory, and we found 24 nests. Of those 34 pairs, the birds brought to fledging were only 9. So 34 pairs produced only 9 chicks. Last year, a similar number of pairs produced 10 chicks. The generally accepted figure is that one pair needs to produce a chick every other year to maintain the population. So our 34 pairs ought to be producing at least 17 chicks. And certainly in the last 2 years, they are very, very far from doing that. And that is one of the reasons for the decline in curlew numbers over recent years, that the chicks are just not that the parents are just not producing chicks. I'm sure the three panelists have direct personal experience of producing, of chick production. Do you want to develop a bit what I just said there? Katharine, you go first, because I know you've got data on this.
So I have worked with breeding curlew as well. And yes, you're right. They're just not producing enough chicks. One of the things we've got quite good at, I would say, is we've figured out a decent way to be able to protect the nest and protect the eggs, which is great. We have sort of, I don't mean totally protected, but we're getting better ways to be able to protect nests. But it's the fledgling stage, which is the bit that's still a mystery. I will admit that it's wonderful to see the chicks start off, but they hide away so quickly and so fast that with their cryptic behaviours, that this is a section that we're missing to actually understand exactly what they're doing in between that final moment of leaving their parents and heading off to the wild to return in a couple of years' time. I'm working with one of the Head Starting curlew projects, and we are hoping in the next year to actually see the first birds come back to understand quite how some of our birds that were released are going to be going into the local populations. And it's this bit that I feel is missing a lot of information, but it's really tricky to be able to follow them. Definitely sort of, we know techniques to try and help them through the egg stage, and we even know some things to try and help them through the initial first few days when they are young chicks who haven't got much feather development. But I feel we need to put more effort into that missing stage, both when they've left their, when they become older chicks and are leaving their parents, through to their first winters, and understanding where they might be going and how they learn where are the best sites. Do they follow other adults, or do they have a bit of a hit and miss, oh, this looks okay sort of feeling? I don't know if that actually answered the question, sorry.
Yeah, thanks, Katharine. Marie, do you want to say something about chick productivity?
I had a number of 1.69 chicks per population and per year to keep a population to keep a enough population. I don't know how to say that. I'm not sure about this number, so I don't would like to say something wrong, but yeah, maybe some of you have heard this number 1.69, and which number, which is this number, maybe? I don't know.
I can't remember if it's 1.69 or 1.66. It's something along that line, the number of chicks per pair to be able to produce a stable population trend. But that's just the bare minimum. I can't remember exactly if it was that number or not. It does sound very familiar. I am much more of a wintering wader ecologist. I apologise. I don't have the breeding numbers at my fingertips.
Nicola, do you want to add anything to that?
Not specifically to that, but if I would just like to, you've been chugging over in my mind the last two questions. And if I may just go back to that, I mean, if curlew action does have capacity beyond, you know, the incredibly important work you're doing in the breeding season, I do think it is an area that you could carve out for yourself, is trying to understand more about the wintering waders that are not on the intertidal land. And you know, continuing the kind of work you do, talking to farmers about making sure that those birds have the right conditions, you know, in conjunction, obviously, with whoever's managing the intertidal land, which I guess is generally protected areas. And I mean, this also leads me to reflect about flyway conservation generally. I mean, I think flyway conservation, because we have to work together, is a way of connecting lots of different actors. So, you know, you said at the beginning, Mike, about the importance of having, you know, good secretariats and civil society organisations in government. And I think flyway conservation is about working from local to global. So using, you know, your on the ground action, the research, and then using scaling that up to deliver action at an international scale, whilst also channeling back down the global sum of knowledge back down so that it can ensure best practice on the ground on the basis of not having to reinvent the wheel, but using the best kind of knowledge. And it's about using every single tool in the kit. You know, we can't save curlews just by looking at the breeding season, just by looking at the non-breeding season, just by science, just by working with farmers. You know, we have to use every single tool in the kit, including treaties and national governments and local governments and NGOs. And I think that, you know, the more that curlew action can help us to, you know, make sure that the tentacles are spread so that all these different actors are helping to deliver every part of what the curlew needs throughout its annual cycle, that's when we're going to have complete success. But prioritising always, you know, the breeding, because we know that's where most of the problem is.
You were talking about flyway conservation there, and I'm sure that most of the people here will know about the Afro-Eurasian Waterbird Agreement. That's the thing. That's the agreement which has been developed under the Convention on Migratory Species, covering all waterbirds going from basically the Arctic right down the Atlantic coast of Europe into the Atlantic coast of Africa and across Central Africa as well. There's long been talk of a similar agreement for the East Asian flyway. Could you fill us in on just where that's gone now and how that links in with the work of the World Coastal Forum?
Well, it's very interesting because, in fact, for some years now, more than a decade, there has been the East Asian Australasian Flyway Partnership, which fulfills the role that AWA does over here, but with a different model, in that rather than it being a strictly binding agreement, it's a partnership, a voluntary partnership of 22 governments and a considerable number of partners, including NGOs and others. And if I'm absolutely honest, I feel that it is delivering real flyway conservation in a more effective way than our treaties are. And also, it's the same in the Americas. You know, they also have these mechanisms. And I think there's something to be said for loose partnerships. And you know, I think one of the reasons why the East Asian Australasian Flyway Partnership is very effective is because everybody's united around this spoonbill sandpiper. Everybody knows how they can play their part towards this one bird. It acts as a superb flagship. And I feel like curlew is another bird that could act in a similar way, like alongside the black-tailed godwit. And it was really great to have the recent meetings, AWA meetings of the black-tailed godwit and curlew action plans. And I know Mary and probably others of you were at that. But the flyway that currently lacks a mechanism is the Central Asian flyway. That's been the only one that doesn't have a flyway. But the Conventional Migratory Species is having its conference of the parties in February. And hopefully there we're expecting an initiative to be launched, thanks to the government of India offering to host a secretariat, a CMS secretariat in India that would help actually get that up and running. And I think that that will learn lessons from both the AWA model and the East Asian Australasian flyway model, because I think, you know, each flyway has different characteristics and it needs different approaches. So it's a matter of finding the what works in different flyways and then applying them to another flyway, if you see what I mean.
Yeah, that's very interesting. When I worked with the Ramsar Convention, we had very close connections with Japan, and our operations with them led to Japan being a very active member of the Ramsar Convention. And it looked a bit like in your pictures of China. In a way, it seems to me that in the Eastern Flyway, once they've decided that they're going to give an international status to a wetland, it really gets all the bells and jingles and it's highly organized, where there are telescopes for every toddler who wants to look at a bird, and all sorts of sculptures. You had some sculptures of spoon-billed sandpipers there, whereas I would have think the European approach is often to say, well, we don't want to put all these things with bells and whistles on them. What we want to leave it natural. So I mean, each to his own, and it's quite interesting that different approach operates in different countries. Thank you for that on the East Asian thing. I think it's really important to know that there are networks, as indeed in the Americas too, where the people are doing things. Can I go back to Katharine for you said that your studies were helping to suggest individual management techniques and improvements that could be done. Would you like to develop that a little bit? And can we also say there's another issue which seems to me of huge importance is disturbance. It's all very well having these coastal protected areas, but if they're open to the public with vast numbers of people walking on footpaths along the edge, that doesn't allow coastal roosts to high tide roosts to develop, and there needs to be a certain control of human access as well. Katharine, over to you.
Thank you. Nice big question. So when I said that we're able to help inform conservation practices, the individual side of thing, I think, is maybe a little bit too specific. For example, what we are able to do with both the GPS data and also the habitat specific results I've been able to produce with my colleagues. I should say it's been a collective approach. It wasn't just me who did all of this. There was a large number of us who were involved in all stages. Identification of areas which people didn't know were being used at different times of day when people do surveys is a really obvious one. So for example, some of the nighttime roosts that we've mentioned that I've kind of said are fluctuate between whether it's sort of tidal stage or whether it's sort of an individual use. But we're still identifying them. And that means that, for example, in Ireland, National Parks and Wildlife Service are very interested in our tracking data, and we've given them copies of it to be able to understand which areas are getting the use from the birds at particular times and areas that they didn't know were being used, that they can then investigate to understand if they need to potentially expand some of their protection areas. Or, for example, like the Kira Islands that weren't known about being used by curlew, they want to investigate and understand whether they are using them just as a roosting site, because a lot of the relocations were overnight, but also whether they might be using any feeding sites around that and whether that adds an additional designation to the island. In Wales, farmers are very interested in whether birds are using their land at different times of day and which parts of their land they're using. Because, for example, we do have agri-environment schemes that do allow people to put in compensation land for curlew in particular. They're one of the species, particularly in Wales, in the glass tier program, that there is a there is an intervention. No, I've forgotten the technical term for within the agri-environment scheme there. There's a particular one that you can put in for Curlew and understanding whether their land might be of importance and use. So we can actually sort of develop on from understanding which habitats are important, at what time of day, expanding the normal range of people surveying, because the vast majority of our surveys are done at high tides. And what they do at low tides is also very important as well. So, yes, it's kind of on a putting through specific thoughts and questions. And that's why we've been sharing our data with people like NPWS in Ireland, National Parks and Wildlife Service, and talking to various other people within the Welsh side of things. NRW are highly aware of all of our work, the Natural Resources Wales. I have forgotten your second question. Sorry, Mike.
Second question was effect of disturbance. And I was going to raise that anyway, but it's been raised on the chat by someone who's asking from the Essex coast whether there are any data available regarding curlews and how they're impacted by recreational disturbance on wintering sites.
So I don't particularly know as much about the Essex coast. I do know that there's been a large number of studies looking at waders and effects of disturbance. A lot of it has been predicting the energetic costs because it's quite energetic to fly. And so every time a bird is disturbed, it both reduces their time available to feed, but also their potential energy they've spent just flying from one place to another. There is research out there showing sort of the amount of time that disturbance can affect birds before it actually causes a serious location problem. But most often, a lot of what the birds do is they start moving to new areas which are undisturbed. And it's making sure that we don't lose those additional sites that they can compensate. There are, I believe the technical term is phenological mismatch. You can use it here as well, in the sense that when birds are out on the lowest edges on the mudflats, there are often people walking along the top edge, and then they have the best opportunity that some of the, with the tidal flats going out, some of the best feeding might be slightly lower down and birds, people might be wandering. But it's that clash in the middle where you have the intersection of people along when the birds are being pushed for food and they're being pushed up with the tides. I will admit I don't know as much about that side of the disturbance as I would like at the moment. I was heavily involved in some modelling back when I did a PhD on the South Coast, looking at the effects of disturbance. And we were looking at the energetic effects and how much could actually be impacted. They were trying to take it into account with some of their protected sort of disturbance areas, but I don't know how much actually practically went. I don't know if the other two know more about how easy it is to actually apply these disturbance areas outside the breeding season.
Thanks, Katharine. One other thought that occurs to me, I was looking at curlews on a high tide roosts on the Severn estuary yesterday, and they sat up on the foreshore on grassland on when the tide was really high. And as the tide seemed to drop, they didn't seem in any very great rush to get back to feeding. They went and sat on mudflats and just went back to sleep. And I'm wondering, perhaps we could ask Marie first, do you think that there is a particular time of the year when they're under stress? Are they in greater danger and in greater need to feed in the really cold midwinter months? Is that a particularly dangerous and difficult period for them, do you think?
In the Petri Shanty in France, we saw that some birds switch inland to feed when the hunting pressure was very high. So it was in January. But as you know, in France, normally the hunting period is forbidden for curlews. Yeah, they hunt, they still hunt some birds. And I think that the problem in January also is that there are many birds in each site. So the competition is more important during this period. So maybe it's the reason that more birds switch inland during this period.
Nicola, do you want to add anything to that? Realising that we have 3 minutes left.
Just looking for the AWAR guidance that they're producing for disturbance, but I think we haven't got a final draft yet, but it might just be, I mean, I can share the draft, and if people are looking at ways to address and minimise disturbance, it could be a useful resource.
Fine. Thanks for that. Well, we are very close to the end of the period. Can I, on behalf of all the participants, thank the three panellists very much indeed for their really interesting and insightful presentations. Can I also say that I've tried to cover the questions that were answered, that were raised in the chat. If anyone as a participant has further questions or would like further advice, please send an email to Curlew Action. We'll try and do what we can. And can I conclude with the usual final reminder that Curlew Action is a charity and tries to raise funds. So if anybody would like to make a donation to the charity, you can do it through the website, and you can be sure that that it will be well used for the benefit of Curlews, and indeed of all those other waders for which Curlew act as a flagship or an umbrella species. So with that, unless any of the speakers want to make a final comment, I think we'll draw the meeting to a conclusion with thanks to everyone. Right, thank you and good night.